Mark. Thank you. well, I'm very chaotic, but I'm in the office right now. Hello. We have screens for this.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Veldhoven. I'm going to start this opening talk with a very short story about this guy. This is Alexander Fleming. In 1928, he discovered penicillin, the first antibiotic. Although in this case, discover is relative. Because what did he do? He published his results in a paper, and the paper disappeared in the closet. It was only 10 years later that a group of scientists stumbled across his paper and thought, well, this could be useful. The American army gave them a lot of money to do their research, and it was not until D-Day in 1944 until there was enough penicillin to treat every wounded soldier. It is a shame that Fleming didn't go public with his results 10 years earlier. Let's say 10 years earlier, then we would not have had it. Then we would have had it at the beginning of the Second World War instead of at the end. Estimates are that penicillin saved around 83 million lives since it has been on the market. And I'm not going to say that your research will save 83 million lives, maybe it will. But what I'm trying to say is that it's very important to go public with your results, to show it to the world. And of course, we understand that it's not easy to do research and outreach at the same time. You all have very busy life, and that is why we at NWO have a couple of initiatives to help you. Next slide, please. Yeah. Okay, the first is every year we award the NWO Physics Valorization Prizes, and with this prize we award €250,000 to Dutch scientists or a scientist group within the field of physics who showed that they were able to make their results, his or her results, useful to the society. Yeah? We award those prizes for 10 years now, and I think we really succeeded in making valorization of research a normal thing to think about, to work with, and to discuss about. And then second, NWO and the budget of NWO increased. There is more money for open competition, for infrastructure, and there is money for the Dutch National Research Agenda, the NWA. And that makes that there are more opportunities for you to get your research funded. And then third, we organize this conference. This conference where you can meet each other, where you can exchange knowledge and ideas, and where you can participate in activities like the business incubator, the communication workshops, and the speed dates. And these activities help you to communicate, to work with each other, with society and with industry. It's important that the industry and also your peers understand what you do. Science flourishes with interaction, and that's exactly what you're going to do today and tomorrow. Okay, and then one last thing. If you want to keep up to date with what we are doing at NWO, our strategy, our plans, and our decisions, please subscribe to our newsletter or connect with us at Twitter or LinkedIn. And don't hesitate to visit the NWO stand in the Benelux Hall today. Our colleagues will be more than happy to meet you and to answer your questions. Okay, thank you. I hope you have a very inspiring meeting here at Veldhoven. And let's enjoy the beauty of science and let's communicate with each other. Okay, now I'm going to give the floor to, I have to look at my paper now, to Alexander Kajetorians, member of the Physics at Veldhoven Program Committee. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Alex Kajetorians, indeed pronounced correctly, from Radboud University. And on behalf of the program committee, I would like to welcome you all here today. Many of you have that's designed at being able to do pattern recognition tasks efficiently in itself. These demands are growing for, let's say, the need for energy efficient ICT. And today it's a pleasure to have one of these pioneers to be our plenary speaker today, Julie Grolier. Her ideas are based on utilizing magnetism and moving spins and being able to see if they can do pattern recognition already at the level of hardware itself. Very difficult and interesting task, which she's going to indulge us in today. Julie's very well decorated scientist. After finishing her PhD in 2003 with Albert Fayyat, she moved on to the Netherlands, actually, so she's no stranger to Veldhoven, and worked since 2005 at CNRS and has moved her way up now to a research team leader since 2013, in which she's now leading a group and utilizing hardware and bio-inspired computing. She's well recognized by people all across fields. She's been decorated with a Jacques Herbrand Prize from the French Academy of Science. She's also recently received the silver medal from CNRS for her new pioneering work in bio-inspired computing. And she's a multiple awardee of the ERC research grant. With that, Julie, my apologies for my bad French. And it's a pleasure from all of us to have you here today. We're very much looking forward to your talk, and thank you for accepting our invitation.
Hello. Ooh, that's hello, good morning, everybody. So first, many thanks for the invitation and this nice introduction. So today, in my talk, I would like to try to share with you my enthusiasm for this field of neuromorphic computing that, as Alex says, focuses on developing hardware that is inspired from the brain. And I hope also to convince you that magnetic oscillators are interesting for this purpose. Okay, so as you probably know, there's been recently extremely impressive progress in the field of artificial intelligence. And nowadays, these algorithms can do better than humans at a variety of tasks. So for example, they can beat world champion humans at checkerboard games like poker or Go. And they can do better than humans that do not pay attention at image recognition and also at image generation. So here you can see on the left of the screen, you can see these faces of people. These are fake people. These people do not exist. So this is one of the latest results by NVIDIA, and it's really, really impressive. However, these algorithms, due to the hardware they are working on, running on, are going to run into some limits. Indeed, you see these algorithms are neural networks. So they are really inspired from the brain, so they are composed by neurons, which are these circles here, connected by synapses, which are these arrows. But today, this physical structure is completely lost in the computers. These neural networks are, their functioning is translated into some lines of codes, and then this code is binarized and sent in processors like CPUs, GPUs, or FPGAs. And so in this process, the physical layout of the neural network is completely lost. And this is imposing some limitations on the efficiency of this neural network in hardware. Indeed, in all these processors, CPUs, GPUs, the common point is that the architecture is similar in the sense that you have a memory block that is specially separated from the processing. And this is a huge constraint in neural networks because these networks are made of millions, hundreds of millions of parameters, which are these synaptic strands that you have to store. And so these networks have to learn, so you need to tune these parameters little by little so that they can perform in the end. And in order to do so, it means that you have to fetch all these parameters in the memory, take them, move them to the logic unit where you are going to do some complex operations, and then put them back in the memory, take them again, and you do this back and forth motion of data constantly. And this is wasting a lot of energy, and this is the reason why today these algorithms are consuming like hundreds of kilowatts or even more, and are really slow and cannot learn in real time. And this architecture is, in fact, extremely different from the architecture of the brain, which, as you know, is a huge neural network. Indeed, in our brain, you have neurons which are doing the processing and that are directly connected by synapses, which can be seen as holding the memory. So it means that synapses are directly giving the memory to neurons, right, in these huge parallel neural networks. And thanks to this special architecture, you don't need to have this back and forth motion of data on large distances. And this proximity of memory and processing allows an extremely good energy consumption. And so typically, you see that the brain consumes 20 watts, which is less than a light bulb, while running huge neural network. We have hundreds of billions of neurons in our brains and 10,000 times more synapses. So this means that it really makes sense to take inspiration from this layout of the brain to build neuromorphic chips that are energy efficient and fast. And so it means that we would like to achieve this kind of structure physically, where we have these neurons, these layers of neurons, these series of layers of neurons connected by synapses. But there is a first challenge. The challenge is that these neural networks, you see with the neurons doing the processing and synapses that are all these parameters, you can see them as some kind of huge fit functions. And of course, as any fit functions, the larger the number of parameters, the better you can fit anything, right? So it's really important for a neural network to have a huge number of parameters. And the larger the number of parameters, the better the neural network is going to perform. And so, typically, in today's neural network, you need hundreds of millions of neurons and even more synapses to do like state-of-the-art image recognition. And so if you make the calculation, if the dream is to make a very small chip like that, 1 cm² chip, that is running neural network very efficiently and with a low energy consumption, and where you have all these numbers of neurons and synapses, if you make the calculation, you see that each device should be smaller than 1 micrometer. So what it means is that there is a first challenge here. We need to find ways to implement nanosynapses and nanoneurons. And for this, we need to develop novel materials. And so what are the features that these nanoneurons and these nanosynapses should have? So of course, we don't know yet how the brain is functioning. So a good way to find the minimum features that these devices should have is to look at how neural network algorithms are working today. And so what these neural network algorithms are really good at is at pattern recognition. So a typical example would be to try to identify cats and dogs in images. So it means that you are going to take megapixel images, so you have millions of pixels at the entrance, and what you want to do in the end is identify whether in this picture you have a cat or a dog. Okay? And so for this, you need to compress the information, because you go from millions of pixels to only 2 neurons at the end, one that is going to flash 1 if it's a cat, the other that is going to say 1 if it's a dog. So in order to compress the information, the first thing that you need is to have nonlinearity. So this is what neurons are doing. They are nonlinear in order to compress information from this mega, this huge input to the very small dimension of the output. And then, in order to get the good answer, in the end, the good output, you see that you need to route the information through the network. And this routing is achieved thanks to the synapses. Synapses, you can see them as some valve for the information. They are going to transmit the information with a given synaptic weight, with a given synaptic strength. And when you train the network, what you do is that you tweak the synaptic weight little by presenting new examples and correcting for errors until, in the end, you have the correct output. And so a neuron is going to receive the weighted sum of the outputs of neurons in the layer before it. Okay, so it's going to receive a weighted sum by the synaptic weights. And this is what is going to guide this information through the network. So what it means for synapses, it means that if we want to do nanosynapses, there should be some analog valves. They should modulate the information in a non-volatile way, because they need to remember these weights. And ideally, they should be able to do this weighted sum of the information. And then, if we are able to do these nanosynapses and these nanoneurons, we will have to face another challenge. And this challenge is the interconnection, the interconnectivity. So today, in neural networks, there are about 10 to 100 synapses per neurons. But you may know that intelligence seems to be growing with the connectivity. And for example, in the human brain, it's not 10 synapses per neuron that we have, it's 10,000 synapses per neuron. It's huge. Here, what you see in this image is a reconstruction of a real brain. This is a part of the retina. And each colored wire here is an axon that connects 2 neurons together. And you see here, I think you really see what is the complexity of having these 10,000 wires per neurons. You see it has to be 3D, it looks like self-assembled, you have to avoid shortcuts between all these wires, and also maybe you can see there is some kind of hole here. This is the place for the blood vessel, so you need to bring in energy to this system that is 3D. So this is a huge challenge. So how can we make nanoneurons and nanosynapses, and how can we interconnect them densely in a human-made hardware system? So the main trend today is the following. The idea is to say, okay, we want to make synapses and neurons, but there are more synapses than neurons, so let's at the beginning try to shrink the size of synapses. This is the more important. So let's make nanosynapses, and let's connect these nanosynapses with neurons made with transistors, with CMOS neurons. So the idea is to use for synapses to use for the information that is going to go through the network is to use electricity, okay? And the idea is to make synapses that are going to modulate electricity, and in order to have a valve for electricity, you know that there is nothing better than to put a resistor here, because the resistor is going to modulate how electrons propagate. So memristors are just nanoresistors that have a tunable conductance, so they can be made with different material, oxide, phase change, and so they can be made really small, and they can be fabricated in these arrays here. So what you see in this array, you see the top electrodes and the bottom electrodes of a crossbar of memristors. So at each crossing of electrode, you have one memristor, you have one of these nanoresistors. And you see that they can be made really densely packed, very compact, and so this can potentially allow to connect neurons very densely. But it's even more interesting like that than that, because if you imagine that these dense arrays of memristors are connected by neurons indeed, and that the neurons here are connected at the red ends of the electrons and provide some voltage here, what you can see is that this voltage is going to propagate through this array of resistive devices, and that the green bottom electrodes, the current that is going to be collected, is due to electricity law, to Kirchhoff laws, is directly the weighted sum of the neural input voltages by the conductances of these devices, of the resistors, okay? And so, thanks to the laws of electricity, you directly implement this weighted sum that is at the core of neural network operations. So this is really a very nice road to connect a lot of neurons together. One of the things is that these are purely resistive devices. So if your crossbar arrays here become too big, the information is just going to take some weird path through these purely resistive arrays. So we can typically imagine to make arrays of about 100 by 100 memristors. So it means that if we want to try to reach, to go to higher connectivity, then we need to find alternative ways. And so the idea is the following. Here it has been proposed to make the neurons in the first plane of CMOS, so with transistors, and then to stack different crossbar arrays of memristors on top and to connect them through vias that will bring the electricity up to these different networks. And so it has been shown theoretically that if you do of 10,000 synapses per neurons. But for now, this is just theory. We are not there yet. People are working on trying to make the first chips that co-integrate CMOS with the first layer of memristors, and I hope that we are going to see them functioning in the next years, and then it will be a huge challenge to stack together these arrays and get to this connectivity, okay? And so this is the main trend today, but in my lab, we are exploring a completely alternative way of trying to achieve this huge connectivity. And so our idea is to say, okay, maybe if we really want to connect a huge number of nano devices together, of objects together, maybe we should try to avoid as much as possible to connect them through wires. Maybe we can rely on other ways, and our idea is to do it through microwaves. After all, we are billions of humans on this Earth, on this web, and we are, all have a smartphone, and almost all have a smartphone, and so we are able to communicate. We are connected through microwaves through these smartphones. And so it seems that, indeed, microwaves could be a good idea to achieve networks that are very densely connected. And so in order to move in this direction, our idea is to use devices which are called spintronic nano-oscillators, spintronic nano-oscillators. So these devices, they are based on magnetic tunnel junctions, which are the device, the elemental device that constitute today magnetic memories. So magnetic tunnel junctions are in fact formed of stacked magnets. You have a first magnet, then you have a thin insulating layer on top of it, then another magnet. And these devices are today, as I was saying, developed for magnetic memory, so they are very mature. This year, four of the major foundries have announced that they are going to integrate these magnetic tunnel junctions in their process routinely, so they will be commercially available to design new circuits. And they can be scaled down to 10 nanometers, and they are, of course, compatible with CMOS. And so, most of the time, they are used as memory, so the idea here is that if the magnetization of the magnets are pointing parallel or anti-parallel, it corresponds to 0 or 1. And magnetic tunnel junction, MRAMs, the memories operate by sending current pulses to switch the magnetization from one direction to the other. Okay, so they can provide memory, but for this microwave communication, we want to use them in another mode. So the idea here is instead of sending current pulses, is to send direct constant current through the devices. So when you do that, when the current goes through the first magnet, so originally it's not spin polarized, so you have as many spin-ups and spin-down electrons, but when it goes through the first magnet, it's going to get some spin, to gather some spin by going through this magnet, okay? And so when it impinges on the second magnet, the current is carrying spin, and it can transfer this spin to the top magnetization. And when the top magnetization gets some spin by the current, it can start to rotate, and if you are in the good condition, it's going to rotate constantly, okay? And so what is really nice is, well, there are many things that are really nice. The first thing is that this magnetization rotation is converted into voltage oscillations because magnetic tunnel junctions are magneto-resistive elements. So when you have a rotating magnetization, it induces a voltage oscillation. So this is what you see here. This voltage trace is an experimental measurement across the magnetic tunnel junction. And you can see that it's very clean and it's easy to measure. The amplitude is about 10 millivolts. What is nice also is the frequency. So it, depending on the materials, depending on the size of the device, it can go from hundreds of megahertz to several tens of gigahertz. And in addition, these emissions are tunable. So as you see, when you send the current, you give some spin to the magnetization, and this is why it starts to rotate. But as you imagine, if you change the amplitude of the current, you are going to transfer more or less spins, and so you are going to make the magnetization process more or less rapidly. So the trajectory, depending on the amplitude of the DC current, the trajectory is going to be modified. So you can go from small oscillation to fast, small oscillation, to slow, large oscillation. And so this is going to change the frequency of your oscillator and is going to change the amplitude. And so what you see here on the right is how the amplitude of the oscillation is changing as a function of the DC current. And so you see what I like with this curve is that it's very nonlinear, and it really, really looks like the activation function, like the nonlinear functions that are used today in artificial neural networks. So this is the key idea of what we want to do. You see here we have a nano device. You give it the input that is a DC current. It's going to apply to this input function that is important for neural networks, that is this nonlinear function. But not only is it going to do this operation thanks to its physics, but because it's a microwave device, it's going to emit the output. And then you can hope to broadcast the output to other neurons. So, okay, we say this is a nice idea, but then we wanted to show that indeed this device could act as a neuron. Because as you know, nano devices, well, they are, because of their small volume, they can be noisy, their properties can drift. There are plenty of problems that can occur and that could lead to bad results. Because when you do processing, when you want to calculate things, you want to give a certain stability of your device. So in order to show, to test the capability of these magnetic tunnel junctions to act as neurons, we said, okay, the best thing is to try to solve a neuromorphic task, to do pattern recognition. But we wanted to start small, so here what we did is that we used a single magnetic tunnel junction, a single oscillator, to emulate a full network, a full neural network. So we used one tunnel junction to emulate a network of 400 neurons. How did we do that? Well, we used time multiplexing. So the tunnel junction, the oscillator, is playing the role of the each neuron in the network one after the other. And by doing so, we have been able to achieve spoken digit recognition. So we took audio files of people pronouncing the digits from 0 to 9. And we showed that this neural network, this experimental neural network, could recognize the digits that was pronounced with a success rate of 99.6%, despite the dispersion of the pronunciations of the different people. And this is a very good result, in fact. This is state-of-the-art for much larger hardware neurons and even for software neurons. So this was a good way to show that the stability of our magnetic devices and their non-linearity was good enough, was giving them the good features for implementing neurons. Okay? But so this was just the first demonstration. And of course, it was only one neuron. And so we need to move to trying to make these neural networks and have these oscillators, these neurons, communicate together. And so for that, they have another very nice advantage is this tunability, this non-linearity that I described before. So here in this graph, you can see how the frequency of these magnetic oscillations changes with the DC current that is injected in the magnetic tunnel junction, but also changes with the magnetic field. And you see that it can change on a huge range. These are hundreds of percent. So they are extremely tunable. And thanks to this very high tunability, they are extremely sensitive also to electromagnetic microwave signals. So when they receive a microwave signal, that can be electrical microwave current or field, they are going to respond strongly to this microwave signal if the frequency is close to their own frequency. And so when they receive a microwave signal, even if this microwave signal has a frequency that is slightly different from their own frequency, they can respond so much that they can synchronize to this input signal. So they can modify their frequency to synchronize to the input signal. And in fact, they are so sensitive that they can also mutually synchronize. So we have shown in the past experimentally that they can be coupled together, interact together, share their frequency thanks to diverse phenomena like spin waves, dipolar couplings, or simply electrical currents. And so this is very interesting for neuromorphic computing, for building networks out of these devices, because indeed, then we can imagine, you see, to have layers of these oscillators that we use as neurons that perform operation and broadcast their results, and then send these results to the next layer of neuron, and so on, thus creating this chain reaction of microwave outputs in neural networks. But of course, this is quite unconventional. So to do this, we need to completely invent new ways to compute with this kind of structure. There are not today algorithms saying how you could perform deep learning with these microwave devices. And so we recently proposed an idea to do so, but it's just an idea. So what I'm going to do here is just show you one way that we could compute using such interconnected microwave devices. There are plenty of other ways and maybe better ways to imagine to move in this direction. So our idea is the following. You see, when you go from the left to the right, each layer is driving the next one, okay? So when here neuron I, you have neuron I and neuron J, right? So if neuron I is strongly driving neuron J, most probably neuron I is going to synchronize neuron J, and they are going to have the same frequency, even if their natural frequency should be different, right? So it means that if we observe synchronization between neurons in two different layers, then probably this means that there is a very strong synapse here, that it's communicating very well. On the contrary, if neuron I and neuron J have different frequencies and they don't interact, it means that the synapse between them is really weak. Okay? And so this is how we are going to try to compute. And so in order to demonstrate this idea, we have implemented experimentally this very small neural network. So we have two layers like that. So we are still working with lab experiments, so we don't have such a huge number of nano devices. So we have four nano devices, four nano neurons that we use to make the second layer here. And for the first layer, for these red neurons, what we use, in fact, is two microwave sources that we have in our lab. And so we have these two-layer neurons. The microwave sources are going to send microwave signals to the second layer, and the second layer is going to try to classify these signals by synchronizing to the inputs. And so, again, we wanted to show that this could be really used for pattern recognition, so we are going to try to do vowel classification. So let me try to guide you through the way we did it. So we took our four nano oscillators and we connected them together through wire bonding. Okay, and so here it's really a simplified view. The setup is much more complicated, but the blue line here, you can see it as a microwave path that is connected to a spectrum analyzer. And in addition to this microwave path, we have the possibility to send through each oscillator a given DC current. So we can control the DC current in the oscillators individually, which means that we can control their frequency, right? And so we have this microwave path and we plug it to a spectrum analyzer and we look at the emission of the oscillators. And here we put four different DC currents. So we have four different microwave peaks because the oscillators all have a different frequency, okay? What is important to notice also is that since each oscillator emits a microwave and this microwave goes through this microwave line through all the other oscillators, each oscillator not only receives the DC current, it also receives the microwave outputs from all the other oscillators. And this modifies the dynamics and couples the oscillator together. But they are not synchronized. You see, they are weakly coupled by this mechanism, but still they can feel each other and respond to each other. Okay, so this is the second layer of the neural network. And of course, if we want to compute something, we need to send the inputs. So in order to send the inputs, what we did is that we fabricated on top of the oscillator a strip line. So it's a metallic line that is about 300 nanometers above the oscillators. And through this line, we send the two microwave inputs that have different frequencies, FA and FB. And so these microwave signals go through the strip line, and by doing so, they are going to generate an electromagnetic field, a magnetic field, on the oscillator, and this magnetic field is going to modify their dynamics. And here, on this graph here, what you see an example of what we can get, and you see how strongly the dynamics of the oscillators can be modified. So here, for this particular configuration of frequency A and B, you see that we don't have four peaks anymore, we have three peaks now of the oscillator. So what has happened is that, you know, the oscillators, they are attracted by the inputs, they would like to lock to the inputs. So what happened here in that particular case is that oscillator 1 and 2 frequency moved towards FA because they were close to FA, so they are pulled by FA. Oscillator 3 didn't change so much, but oscillator 4 was so strongly attracted to FB, to source B, that it's completely synchronized to this source. So in fact, it's here that you have to believe me, I'm sorry, because I cannot show you extensively, but here, it's not that the peak of oscillator 4 has disappeared, it's that it is synchronized to source B. This is something that we have studied a lot in the past, and so we know it very well. Okay, and so why it seems to have disappeared is because when it's locked to the microwave input, it acquires the spectral purity of the input. Its phase is so constrained that it becomes very pure. Okay, so here this is a special case where we have a given synchronization configuration where oscillator 4 is synced to source B. But of course, this is going to depend on the frequencies of the inputs. And so when we vary the frequencies of the input, we can get all kinds of synchronization configuration. And these are the experimental results here, where we show in this map, in different colors, the different synchronization configurations that we can obtain. And so what I have just shown you is corresponds to this white, kind of whitish region, where oscillator 4 was synchronized to input B. But we can get other kind of synchronization configurations. So for example, oscillator 1 in this pale blue region is synchronized to input A. And sometimes we have a mixed configuration where 3 is synchronized to A and 4 to B in the purple region. All right? And so what we want to do is to take advantage of these synchronization configurations to compute, to classify inputs. So here is what we did. We took a database that you can find on internet. It's a Michigan database of vowels. So in this database, you can find the audio files of different vowels pronounced by different speakers. And so a vowel is characterized by many frequencies that are called formants. So typically, to recognize a vowel, you need there are about 12 formants. This is what you need, and you can find them in this database. And so these are our inputs. And then we have these formant frequencies, and we need to plug them into our system, to connect them to these two microwave sources that we have. Okay, and so it means that there are two things that we need to do. We need to reduce the dimensionality because we have these 12 inputs. We have only two microwave sources. So our second layer only has two neurons. And then, of course, vowels are not form the frequency from kilohertz to hundreds of megahertz. So in order to do that, what we did is that we took the formant frequencies and we did two linear combinations that are shown here, and that in fact kind of correspond to a first layer of a three-layer neural network. Okay, and so then this brings the signals of the input to megahertz frequencies, and then it goes to the oscillators. So after this first layer, after this linear combination, this is how the data looks like. So you see we have 7 American vowels that all have a different color in this map. And what you can see is that each vowel corresponds is doing some kind of cloud. And each point here corresponds to a different speaker. And you see that the vowels are grouped together, but there is some dispersion because, of course, the speaker have all a different different pronunciation. And so if we want to classify, how can we recognize the vowel with our system? Well, the idea here, you see, is simple. We want that independently of the speaker, we generate the same synchronization configuration for each input vowel. We want that independently of the point here in the yellow cloud, we have the same synchronization configuration. But here, at the beginning, it doesn't work because the network is random. It has to be trained. And so you see that the clouds here of vowels are not contained inside single synchronization regions. So this network needs to be trained. And so this is what we have done experimentally. So you see here our experimental room. So the oscillators are inside an electromagnet. The vowels are provided by the two microwave sources that you can see. So what we do is that the microwave source sends the signal of the vowel. This is sent to the oscillators. We record the signal on the spectrum analyzer. There, we have the computer that analyzes the synchronization configuration. If this synchronization configuration corresponds to what we want for the input, we don't change anything. But if it's not good, if we have some error, we have invented a small learning algorithm that allows to change a little bit the frequency of the oscillator so that they move a little bit towards the desired synchronization configuration. And so we repeat this procedure little by little until the network is going to learn. And so I'm going to show you how it looks like. So what you are going to see here, you are going to see how the configuration of synchronization evolves during learning, and you are going to see how this correlates to the recognition rate here, and also how the recognition rate evolves, and how the DC current and the oscillator frequency change during training. Okay, so here you see the modification of the synchronization map, and you see how when the network is evolving and learns, the recognition rate increases. At some point, it saturates, and we reach a recognition rate for the seven vowels of 85%. And you see that in the end, the network did as well as it could, and indeed, the clouds of vowels are more or less contained in different synchronization regions. Okay, so it's nice, the network has learned something, and we have obtained this recognition rate of 85%. So we were happy, but also we wanted to benchmark this result. Okay, so in order to benchmark this result, what we did is that we took our database and we feed it to state-of-the-art neural network in simulation, that is a multilayer perceptron. And the performance of the multilayer perceptron here are shown in this graph in the middle with the black squares. And of course, this is a state-of-the-art neural network in software. So if you give it a lot of training parameters, and the training parameters are the synapses shown here in red, you see that it does very, very well. It can recognize the vowels with a recognition rate above 97%. Okay? But what you see also is that when you reduce the number of trained parameters, the result really drops very fast. And for a small number of trained parameters, similar to our small experimental neural network, you see that in fact, our oscillatory neural network with only four oscillators, which is a red star, is doing better than this software multilayer perceptron. So, we were surprised by this, and we tried to understand why our experimental noisy neural network with an oscillator can do better than a perceptron. And in fact, we thought this is due to the fact that you see that in a perceptron, if you look at these seven neurons at the output, they are not connected together. They don't talk to each other. They give their response independently of each other. On the contrary, in our case, we have these oscillators that are coupled together and that take the decision for the output collectively, okay? And so we thought maybe it's the coupling between the oscillators that helps to have a good result. And indeed, we have performed some simulations here, so these are not experiments. Here what you see are simulations of the system. You see that we can reproduce very well the behavior of the network, and you see that indeed the recognition rate increases strongly when this coupling between the oscillator increases. And this is because when the oscillator are coupled, they help each other to synchronize to the incoming inputs. So it increases the synchronization regions and it improves the recognition rate. And so in fact, we found out that in theory, we can even reach higher results. So this is the black star if we have no noise in the network. Okay, so the takeout message here is that we believe that indeed, so it means that if we add some additional features to our experimental hardware neurons, like for example, their oscillatory nature, their ability to couple, maybe we can improve the recognition rate of neural networks. But for this, we need to, I mean, this is true for this very small network, and we need to see how we could scale this to very large neural networks. Okay, so this was a very first demonstration, so with only a few number of neurons. So what's next? Well, we are very ambitious, and so we would really like to go to this kind of huge network, deep networks that are connected through microwaves. And so first, we need to estimate what is the size of each layer, how many neurons, how many oscillators can we put in each layer. So recently we did some simulations and we have estimated that in fact we can make some kind of modules where you have all these oscillators that have different frequencies and that have similar synchronization range. So and we can, given the fabrication constraints and everything, we estimate that we can make modules of about 100 to 300 oscillators. Okay? And so it means that if we want to do these deep networks, we need to compose with some kind of tiles of these hundreds of oscillators that communicate together through microwaves. And then the next challenge is that we need to insert synapses. So in what we have done until now, you see that we have sent directly the output of the microwave sources to the oscillators. And so we could, in a way, imitate the synapse through the strength of these amplitudes and changing the frequencies. But if we want to do better, we really need to have devices that are going to tune these signals. And so this is something we are working on now, and we are optimistic because spintronics is a very nice technology for that because it's extremely multifunctional. As we have seen, magnetic tunnel junction can provide memory, but you can also tune their properties a lot by using different materials. You can not only use ferromagnets, but you can use anti-ferromagnets. You can use many different controls to change their behavior by using spin torques, spin orbit torques, magnetoelectric effects, and in particular, it has been shown recently that you can implement memristive behaviors with anti-ferromagnets driven by spin orbit torques. And finally, to conclude this talk, I would like to say that I think that spintronics is interesting because you can do these microwave neurons, you can imagine to do these synapses, but it's even more than that. Given the multifunctionality of spintronics, you can really imagine to build 3D systems that communicate through microwaves in 3D, but also that possibly emit solitons or spin waves in all the directions and compute through the physics. And so that is something we are going to try to explore in the future. So thank you very much for your attention.
So thank you, Julie, for this beautiful tour through brain-inspired computing. So to the rest of you, I would like to invite you to enjoy this wonderful conference on behalf of the program committee. And I would like to spend the 30 seconds I have to advertise that we have 4 live experiments in the hall outside and 4 booths. So while you're enjoying your lunch, you can also visit these booths. And NVO has promised to answer any question posed to it at one of them. So I challenge you to also go visit this booth. And with that, I would like to thank you again and thank Julie Grolier once again for her talk, and have a good conference.